shit that keep him buzzing. Hey, would I even say it if he wasn't calling me though? Hey, okay. Made it.
Stand here. The sun is down, but I hope you're still up. Another day, another cyber psycho attack. The latest comes from a car shop in the North Side Industrial.
Come to think of it, I could just drive over there.
But fear not, good people. Our boys and girls in blue at the NCPD actually managed to put a stop to the psycho and the carnage. Stand here. The sun is down, but I hope you're still up. Is it a mirage? A hologram? No, my friends. It's clear, open skies. But don't take it from me. Get out there and enjoy the sun.
Looks like there isn't even a road. Ball in my sock, I'm trying to make it double too quick. If you try to talk, it should be money, no excuses. Drill Illuminati, Illuminati on the loomis. Riding on Illuminati the on the loose. No fatties, hyper focus on the paper. No addies, line my style phone with the red. Moving real slick, getting sly on the fence. On the bed, yeah. Oh, they don't want to know, they don't want to go. Tell them all back. Whoops. You don't want to see me close. Got a few backpacks, all depending on the dough. Ride a Gucci Fendi dance, like we both are matching.
My God, the fish tailing.
That's something.
Should get my lean, maybe.
I make door-to-door deliveries. Time to neutralize the perp in progress. Who are these baddies? Fanatic. See, now it says, right, it says fanatic, but not anything else. Let's start things off with a bang. Get up. Thank you. See, things turn dark after I kill the last enemy. I thought it was just me, but no, it got dark after I killed the last enemy. Huh. Oh, look at me. I forgot I have hardly any ammo for that weapon. Alright. Those were easy. There's something else. Commissioner Falter and Alexandra Zatiskova. Boy, no, I wanted to read that. It went away too quick. 522 euros. I can level up too. Shards. I got some new stuff to read, too. Here we go. Commissioner Falter. Boys are on their way. Should be like sitting ducks at a shooting range. Alexandra says, okay, we'll take care of it. Commissioner says, good, thanks. Nothing worse than a bunch of brown-nosing go-getters. No prob. You scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. What's this order?
Yo, screw that guy. Stuff costs more every damn shipment. Let's kill this biz. Order a crap ton of merch. I almost messed it up. And when you go to grab it, lead to the skull, done. We'll find another supplier. I gotta go someplace cool and read this stuff. I got a few new things. Corporate Wars the Musical. That's awesome. There we go. Another assault in progress. Sturdy manganese something or other. Well, there's a police car. I just noticed it was a cop car. And there's a dead cop. Well. Are they just, like, telling me about the one I'm already at? They want me to check out something with the car. I'll be right there. All kinds of ammo except for the one I'm already, like, need more of. Want me to pick up this new titanium pleated ballistic vest in conversation with Commissioner Falter and Reggie Loeb? Any relation to Lisa Loeb? Commissioner says, Reggie, my boy, got something urgent. Sure, I'm all yours. We got a report of a suspicious van in NID, taped up windows, no plates. Drone images show people inside. Could have something to do with your guy's case, but you gotta act fast. Reggie says, understood, we're on our way. Thanks, Reggie. I knew I could count on you. It's an honor to serve alongside boys like you. Reggie says, thanks, Chief. Alright, so what's this thing I got? Some kind of gun? Well, let's break some stuff down while I... Crusher. Okay. Power pistol. Once I got that solved the case. Go figure. Let's go up here and read this stuff I got. Let's see, save. Let's level up. I can do another attribute point. I think I'll put body or reflexes next time, but I just want to get intelligence up. Look at that. Oh, that's the relic. Oh. This used to be Blink. Alright, perk point. automatically highlights nearby access points. Okay. Oh wait, I already have that. Never mind. I get confused with the colors of these things. Increases the breach time for breach protocol by 20%. On a quick hacking. Yeah, I'll get this one. Reducing required cyberdeck RAM for quick hacks by 2 units. On devices only, it looks like. Now save again. Because crashing is the name of the game lately. So let's see what we got. Caught in the maelstrom. I'm stood in the middle of Totentons, my knuckles white, tightly gripped on Achilles' M179E rifle. It was shoved into my hands just seconds before the attack. My face, arms, and sin leather jacket soaked in the blood and brain matter of the psycho I had just shot. My contact, a 30-year-old maelstromer with a green mohawk, patted me on the shoulder. "Man, Phil, you ain't half crap," he tells me appreciatively. "Took you for a, you know, but you gotta admit, you got some steel-clad balls after all, and don't worry about that sad scrap heap. If there ain't at least 20 bodies, you can't call it a maelstrom party." What had already been an unsettling experience took a turn to a whole other level. The other maelstromers continued to mock me, but I could detect a tone of approval through all the vocal distortion. My mohawked contact, that's a word you don't see very often, mohawked, even proposed that they install in me one of their distinct rudimentary implants. Fortunately, they didn't have in mind... iconic optic suite, so I accepted. My popularity continued to grow. "No way you'd get the maelstrom mug so easy," he laughs. "That tech's only for initiates. We pluck out your eyes and peel back the skin. No anesthetics. You survive, you're in." With the atmosphere now more relaxed, okay, I asked if the rumors had been true. Did they accept contract killings? My mohawked source nodded with enthusiasm. "Oh yeah, we make good scratch, and it's a great morale booster. You know, machines ain't bothered with a mess of feelings, and that's what we aim for. Doing hit jobs like that helps us gouge out all the gooey emotions we still got left. Recently, this one guy got all whiny and snot-nosed just because we roasted some kid. I told him, I said, 'Dude, you better relive some suppressor BD and fast, or a boss man's gonna blow your head off.' The gonk should have listened." As I listened to his explanations and anecdotes, I realized that amusement clearly must not be one of their blacklisted emotions. And then I couldn't help but wonder, are machines capable of laughter? Depends on the machine. The truth about cyberpsychosis. I've had enough of the senseless shootings that claim hundreds of innocents every day. I'm sick of the satire on empty, dead-end implant restriction dialogue. I'm tired of ignoring the cyberpsychosis problem. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if I hadn't already read this, but it does say new. In American society today, there are still a lot of common myths and misconceptions about the so-called technology-related personality disorders. People think they can become infected in sketchy Ripper Doc clinics. Scientists allegedly disagree about the causes of the disease, or even about whether it exists at all. Maybe their tune would change if a cyberpsycho turned their lab into a slaughterhouse. But even then, I doubt it. They're not getting fat paychecks from the cyberware lobby just to openly declare to the public all the nasty possible side effects that come packaged with their products. I've conducted my own research on cyberpsychosis. With supreme confidence, I can confirm this illness is indeed a byproduct of the modern lifestyle and the obsessive emphasis placed on incorporating modern tech into our lives. Although cybernetic implants can directly affect our brain chemistry, they still serve only as a catalyst for the onset of the disease. Our world is subject to extensive dehumanization. We surround ourselves with increasingly more automated machines and artificial intelligences. Our loved ones replace their nature-given eyes, lips, and faces with masks of metal. Some of us begin to lose sight of what is human. We slip into feelings of total alienation and deep-rooted panic. We lose the ability to distinguish between what is real and what is only artificial, digital, synthetic. Such people begin to isolate themselves, lose their empathy for others, and undergo dramatic mood swings that exhibit sadistic tendencies. The most frightening component to all this, however, is that most will never be diagnosed. Not all cyberpsychos are known war veterans or former mercenaries equipped with Sandivistan reflex tech. Not all will go out in a blaze of gunfire with max tech. Many cyberpsychos in our world possess only a single implant, a knee, a liver. They are unseen, unnoticed. They lock themselves up and shut out their friends, colleagues, and loved ones. The world outside of the net and their delusions has disappeared from conscious thought. They are sick and alone, and no one is doing a thing about it. There's no eloquent summary to be made here. Let the value of this manifesto be measured by the fact that I was expelled from the Zeta Tech Cybernetics research team for having written it. Wislawa Szymborska, Labyrinth, excerpt. So this way or that, or no the other, by ear or by your gut, by your wits or by shortcut, by any means necessary, cutting crooked corners past whatever row in a row of corridors and gates, quickly, in the meantime, your time grows short, from one place to another, to one of many still open, of darkness and plight, but also delight, held just ajar, where there's joy, though sorrow, lies well nigh nearby, and elsewhere, somewhere, wheresoever and whereabout, fortune in misfortune, like a parenthetical parentheses, acceptance of it all, and suddenly, a fall. Alright. Oh, seems like a poem. Little favor. Okay, this is just a thing I forgot to read. Dwayne, party's tomorrow. Need something preem. I mean something that'll burst your skull sponge. I want people screaming rainbows and blowing technicolor chunks. What? Some stuff that'll make the come down seem like a bad trip. I got the eddies. You got what I need. You'll be the richest dealer in this town. Let me know, Chum. Parallel lives. It being my purpose to write the lives of Alexander the King and of Caesar, by whom Pompeii was destroyed. Didn't Pompeii have an I at the end? The multitude of their great actions affords so large a field that I were to blame if I should not, by way of apology, forewarn my reader they have chosen rather to epitomize the most celebrated parts of their story than to insist at large on every particular circumstance of it. It must be borne in mind that my design is not to write histories, but lives. And the most glorious exploits do not always furnish us with the clearest discoveries of virtue or vice in men. Sometimes a matter of less moment, an expression or a jest, informs us better of their characters and inclinations than the most famous sieges, the greatest armaments, or the bloodiest battles whatsoever. Therefore, as portrait painters, or more exact in the lines of features of the face in which the character is seen than in other parts of the body, so I must be allowed to give my more particular attention to the marks and indications of the souls of men, and while I endeavor by these to portray their lives, may be free to leave more weighty matters and great battles to be treated of by others. There's some long sentences in there. My name spelled D-Z-E-N-G for bleep's sake. I'll be honest, I didn't want to write this book, but they paid me, so here it is. Well enough, it was written by a ghostwriter. Hey, Jake. Just kidding. I haven't lost all my self-respect. Not yet. So, who even reads books nowadays? I thought people only bought them to decorate their apartments. At least that's what I do. By the way, wouldn't it be better to just get rid of shelves altogether? Something to think about. So, where was I? All right. The publisher told me that they want to publish my autobiography, and do I have any questions? Of course, I asked them if I could swear like the drunken sailor I am, And they said, sure, we'll see. Okay. Hey, it works. Now that that's over with, let's move on. You might have seen me on TV where I host a satirical show called Info Flash. It's a pretty sweet gig. Once a week I get to read smarmy jokes of a teleprompter written by our interns, and they pay me more than you make in a year. Isn't capitalism fabulous? Alright, but how did I get here, you ask? Simple. One of my dad's colleagues was a showrunner at N54 News, and suddenly I found myself going around with a coffee pot. Refills, anyone? It was all unpaid, of course. Apart from that, there wasn't much to do. So you should usually find me out back, taking one of my 100 or so daily smoke breaks. For some reason, people thought I was funny. Somehow the stuff that came out of my mouth made grown men cry with laughter, so they plopped me down in front of a camera, and I just kind of winged it from there. So how do you get to where I am? Well, you can't, because your dad doesn't have a showrunner friend at NVD4. How do you know my dad? And it's not like they're going to pluck some rondo off the street. Don't you know people like me aren't supposed to rub shoulders with bottom feeders like you? Oh, and did I already mention that capitalism is fabulous? Alright. That book sucks. And finally... well, there's a few more. Three more. Corporate Wars, the musical. Absolutely phenomenal. Ziggy Q. True to art and history. Karina Lee. There were many explosions. Jillian Jordan, N54 News. Act 1. The fourth corporate war is underway. Saburo Arasaka is displeased with the progress of his son Kei, who is commanding Arasaka's forces. He instructs Kei to defeat the enemy in order to prove himself as a worthy successor. Kei desires above all to gain the acceptance and pride of his cruel father, so he devises a scheme to place all blame of the war's outbreak squarely on Militech. Their conversation is overheard by Sarah, a Militech agent, and also the beloved adopted father of General Donald Lundy. Sarah concludes that the only way to quickly end the bloody conflict is to assassinate Kay. General Lundy comforts his daughter and gives her courage. Soon, Andrew, a young idealist and idolater of Saburo, arrives in Night City. His dream is to find the last living seagull in the world. So he attempts to stow away, on board an Arasaka ship. Then he is discovered, apprehended, and mocked by Arasaka security personnel. Meanwhile, Sarah is preparing her ambush against Kay, who is due to inspect the ship the very same day. When her target appears, Sarah is poised to fire her gun when suddenly her eyes lock with Andrew's. Time stops, sparks fly, young love is born. Brother. After a moment, Sarah shakes free of her daze and fires at Kay. She misses. Andrew then intervenes, shielding Kay with his own body. The Militech agents must flee the scene. Well, that's funny. It's like, love at first sight, but then she shoots him anyway. Or tries to. Kay had noticed a twinkle in the eyes of the young lovers when their eyes met. Under the guise of gratitude for saving his life, he decides to use Andrew as bait in a trap for Sarah. He orders his scientists to heal the young man's gunshot wound and secretly install a synthetic heart containing a nuclear bomb. He formally accepts the young grateful man into the Arasaka armed forces, and, knowing Andrew's reason for stowing away, he convinces him that Militech is responsible for the destruction of the marine ecosystem and seagull population. Act 2. Sarah returns to General Lundy after failing her mission. With the father's love, he is able to forgive her, comfort her, and offer her a chance at redemption. He assigns Sarah to lead the charge on Arasaka Tower and end this nightmarish war for good. Still smitten from their brief encounter, Sarah and Andrew simultaneously come up with the same plan to search for the other in cyberspace. By chance, they find each other... Okay, it's Andrew, not Kay. Oh, I get it. I didn't read that wrong. I guess that went to my brain wrong. So Sarah and Andrew, but then she shoots at Kay. By chance, they find each other at a virtual coral reef. At first, they are overwhelmed with the unbridled passion of new love, but quickly realize they can never be together. Andrew erroneously accuses Militech of destroying the original coral reef, causing Sarah to realize her beloved has become a member of Arasaka's security forces. Both corporations are preparing for their final confrontation. Andrew and Sarah mourn their unrequited love. Well, it's requited. It's just... like, what do they call it? When the two love each other but can't be together. Star something. Can't remember it. Star-crossed lovers. Yeah. Star-crossed. General Lundy worries over the risk his soldiers face. Saburo reminds his son that he has only one more chance to earn his father's pride and respect. Kay has come to the conclusion that his victory cannot be assured, so he decides instead to blow up Arasaka Tower and pin the blame on Militech in hopes of earning his father's love in death. Oh boy. So dramatic, huh? Sarah's unit enters Arasaka Tower. The two lovers meet as battle rages on around them, but neither can bring themselves to harm the other. Kay attempts to detonate the bomb in Andrew's heart, but the detonator fails. Struck with a nefarious idea, Kay instead shoots Sarah, killing her on the spot. Oh, God. I don't like this story. Andrew's heart breaks with grief, causing the bomb inside to detonate. Really? His heart breaks and then physically sets off the bomb. Oh, whatever. In the moment before the explosion, Andrew gazes up into the sky and witnesses a seagull soaring overhead. The nuclear bomb explodes, destroying the tower, the young man, the seagull, and his dreams. Andrew's lament. I dreamed a dream of an endless sea. Arasaka at the helm. Today my dreams are nothing but mist, and I'm nothing but down. My eyes wished never to see again. Covered in a sea foam veil of gray, I now see only the black abyss, my chrome heart gnarled in pain. Arasaka Corp. bought my soul in exchange for blood and mourn. The strength in me has forever died, and a corporal rat was born. Alright. Chemicals. The invisible killer. We've long known that AVs crisscrossing our skies are busy dumping harmful substances in the air, such as aluminum, carbon dioxide, sulfur trioxide, and sulfuric acid. Studies have also revealed the presence of dead red blood cells and E. coli, as well as sodium chloride, table salt. Now, you don't need a degree in science to know the harm these substances can wreak on the body. We found that sulfur compounds can lead to cancer, heart disease, and other illnesses arising from a weakened or even damaged immune system. They can also lead to spontaneous dental hydroplosion and acute meningitis. What's dental hydroplosion? The air, the water in your mouth explodes? Operation Carpe Noctem. Oh! This is that thing, okay. Oh, didn't like that one. 55. Data mine quick hacks. Makes a copy of the demon infecting the shard. Oh, now I can read it. For Night Corp internal use only, the tests have come back successful. The artificial intelligence CN07 has proven itself capable of bypassing commercial, device-specific, and macro security systems accessible to Night Corp employees of the lowest ranks. None of the test subjects were aware that this experiment was being conducted on them. In compliance with the orders it was given, CN07 focused mostly on subject HK13, which at the time of the experiment's commencement was classified as calm and empathetic. After a period of subliminal conditioning, as we predicted, HK13 began to display acute psychopathic behavior. The highlight was a dispute over coffee, during which HK-13 strangled one of their colleagues, then jumped out the 16th floor of the research facility. We will soon commence the next phase of the procedure and install CN-07 onto the devices of our actual target. Who's their actual target? There's some dark chocolate. Now, is that still here in my inventory? No, I don't see it there. So, oh, there's my van. I guess we're heading here next. Another organized crime, a reported crime, a reported crime, assault in progress. Is that all we have left around here? There's a thievery thing. That's a quartz thing. Cyberpsychos I'm doing later. So I can't head right to this? I guess it's because of the wall. Okay. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode, and we help out with more assaults in progress and stuff like that. And a thievery thrown in the middle. Thanks for watching, and always seek adventure.